Let me find the remote here. Okay, well, let me just, a little introduction here. All the pictures you're going to see come from the collection of the Historical Society, with a couple exceptions, and I'll point them out as we go along. A few years ago, more than a few years ago now, when I first got involved with the sports program at the high school, people started telling me these stories, and since I wasn't a Phoenixville native, about the Union Club of Phoenixville, and it was a pro football team, and it was a world championship team, etc. And I said, okay, I kind of put that on the back burner, and I got interested in early high school sports. And then when I got involved with the Historical Society, my predecessor, Pete Bamberger, what he had done was, we have all the Phoenixville newspapers on microfilm, and he went back to the turn of the century and literally went through the sports section of every issue of the Daily Republican from between 1900 and 1910 up into the 1920s, and duplicated, photocopied every page that dealt with the Union Club. And we have this massive notebook down at the Historical Society where you go page by page. Well, that got me interested in early football in Phoenixville, because when I was involved with the sports, I used to interact a lot with Jack Jeffers, who was the sports editor for the Daily Republican and then the Phoenix for a long time. And he used to write a column called Splinters from the Press Box, if some of you remember that.
Yes.
And he would bend my ear with these old stories about legendary coaches and legendary players, half of which I think was a little bit of hot air and hero worship from when he was a kid growing up in Phoenixville. But it made me think a little bit about how much sports is a reflection of a lot of the history of communities in general. Yeah. So I started to do some research about it. About 5 years ago, I did some research and did an article about the Union Club, and that led me to some other things. So I put together a program on the early history of football in Phoenixville. Hello, Pete. And what we're going to do is we're going to take a look at Phoenixville from when football first started in the 1890s, and we're going to go up to World War II. World War II is kind of a natural breakpoint. Things happened during the war that changed the nature of how high school football got played. After the war, some of the structures of leagues that were formed started to change, etc. So we're going to talk about early football, and that means we're talking about some of the teams, some of the players, and how different the equipment was and the rules were. We've been all watching football games, and we're used to seeing games that are 15-minute quarters and four downs to get a first down to keep possession of the ball, and that a touchdown's worth 6 points, and extra points 1 point or two now, and a field goal's worth 3 points. That's not always been the case. And in fact, in the early years of football, you had three downs to go 5 yards. And in fact, a touchdown was worth only 5 points, for example. So we're going to take a look at some of those things. The greatest source of information on the early years of Phoenixville football was this book, 57 Years of Phoenixville Football. I think we probably still have a copy in the library here. We have several down at the Historical Society. It was published in 1949, and still contains more information about football in Phoenixville than just about any other source. At the time that it was written, Paul Jones and the other people that helped him compile it had the opportunity to interview many people who had played football in the first couple decades of the 20th century. They're still alive and could interview them. And he had the opportunity to borrow from those people a great collection of photographs of early teams in Phoenixville history. So I just wanted to give a plug to that book. Football first came to Phoenixville, believe it or not, in 1892. In 1892, two of the children of the Reeves family, on the Reeves estate, bought two footballs from a sporting goods dealer in Philadelphia. And they formed a little neighborhood team. This is a shot of the team and they called themselves the Rosebuds. It's not a very ferocious name for a football team. We're used to Vikings and Wolverines and whatever. But they called, and they played on a field they laid out actually on the Reeves property called Star Street. And they were the beginnings of football. Football was really in its infancy in the United States. It was kind of evolving from a number of sports like rugby, for example. And so the rules were very fluid. It wasn't until the late 1880s and 90s they started writing rule books and trying to standardize even the size of the field. We go back to 1900, fields were 110 yards long, for example, and not 100 yards long. And there were a lot of other things that were different.
Was that one kid wearing a tie?
Pardon?
Was that one kid wearing a tie?
Yep. Yep, but he has his shirt tail out, so that
makes it okay. Well.
So the first teams that were formed in Phoenixville was called the Phoenixville Athletic Association, or the Phoenix Athletic Association. You can see early writings that are listed both ways. And they would play teams from local communities, athletic associations that got formed in Spring City, Royersford, Norristown, Conshohocken, etc. And in their first 3 years, they gave up only 5 points in their games. Now, the rules of football were very, very different in the early years. For example, the forward pass was not legal until 1905. So when I was growing up, I'd always hear these stories about Woody Hayes in Ohio State, and he hated to throw the ball. It was 3 yards in a cloud of dust. And basically, you had to run the ball, or you could lateral it or pitch back to somebody, but it was basically running with the ball. So you had low-scoring games. See, that scores of 7-0. A lot of early games actually ended 0-0 ties. They'd often play, they'd disagree on the number of minutes that would be played. A lot of changes. But this is the Phoenix Athletic Association team in 1893. You'll notice the clothing that they wore, no helmets, kind of quilted pants, no shoulder pads, and the equipment was pretty primitive in those days. If you look closely, the other thing you'll see is the ball was shaped differently. It was much more oval, closer to a rugby ball than today's modern football, and that's because they didn't have to throw it, of course. It was basically tucking it in under your arm or pitching it to somebody and running with it. And they were a very successful team from the 1890s. And we can find different shots of them. They're usually team pictures that you'll find. This is their 1904 team that they claim to be champions of the Schuylkill Valley. That's because they played teams up in Pennsburg and up and down this region. What I want you to particularly focus in on this picture is, let me grab my pencil and use it as a pointer here, is this fellow right here. He is wearing some of the earliest protective football equipment. That is a nose guard. And that was in case you had been whacked in the nose a few times and you either had a broken nose. And players started wearing them. This fellow's got one too around his neck. And they are among the earliest protective equipment that people would wear. Here's their 1908 team. And this is when they started wearing leggings with padding on them as well. The equipment undergoes a lot of changes. Here are one of those nose guards in the upper right-hand corner. These are some of the early shoulder pads that were developed in the first decade or so of the 20th century. And these are two of the early helmets that were worn. Initially, what they were aimed at designed to do was protect your ears more than anything else. Because when they would have piles and so on, pulling on the ears, biting on the ears was a common practice, pretty much anything else. And also grabbing guys by the nose, too, and so on. The reason for that, and here's another one, give you a couple examples of it. The one on the right is an early, a very early one that got used when they started pro football. But guys that wore helmets were considered kind of sissies, in fact, in the early years. But there's some examples of shoulder pads where you would just have leather pads that were sewn right onto the jerseys that they wore, or a quilted kind of thing. When there's a fellow with one of the nose guards over there. And the scoring was different. These are the points you would get for a touchdown over the years. Didn't become standard as 6 points for a touchdown until the beginning in the 19-teens. And you can see that the points for a touchdown, field goal, the extra point, and all that really underwent a lot of changes. A lot of that's reflective of the rules changes that took place. Because today there are all sorts of rules designed to protect players. And in the early years, there were virtually no rules to protect players, and anything goes. And one of the most common things that teams would do is they would line up and form what was called a wedge formation or a V formation. And if I could borrow Pete for a minute, come here, we'll use a little visual aid. What would happen is the linemen would all be shoulder to shoulder. Sometimes they lock arms, and then the center would pitch the ball back to the quarterback, and they'd all go forward at the same time to, in effect, pile drive the opponents and knock them down. Now what happened is teams developed a defense against that formation. And what would happen is one of the players on the defense, when they saw them doing that, would yell something like flat, and two of the guys would drop down and the whole line would fall over top, trip over them. And then the players in the back could jump over them after the ball carrier. You can imagine how many broken arms, crushed fingers, and whatever else could happen when those kind of things happen. And in fact, in 1905, there were 19 football players killed in the United States. And it's one of the reasons why the NCAA was formed, to try to develop a rule system for the sport, etc. And in fact, it's interesting, one of the early coaches in Phoenixville ultimately became the person that was the guardian of the rule book for college football in the United States. And in fact, he was a coach of the Union Club, which I'll talk about in a moment here. So things were very, very different. You can see on these two pictures of the shape of the ball and how much different it is. A lot of the team pictures you see, somebody had a small child or an animal was the team mascot kind of thing. This is actually, this little boy is from the high school team during the 19-teens. So in the early years, and until World War II, there were a lot of these community teams. And they, some of them would last for 8, 9, 10 years, and others would last a couple years. And they would be regional teams. It was a team at one time for a couple years in the 1930s. It was called the West Enders, and they were kids from the West End. And there were kids who lived on the north side of Phoenixville that were called the Daytons, for example, because of Dayton Street. And so you had these kind of teams for them. But you also had teams of young men that were local factory workers that would form teams. And they would play other sports teams and associations from other communities. Some of the churches in Phoenixville had sports teams. For example, some of the industries in the area had sports teams. There was a boys club in Phoenixville. They had a football team. This is their 1911 team photograph. This is from an old glass negative. You can see the crack from the glass negative on this Phoenix Boys Club. This is the 1911 independent team of Phoenixville, although they played on a field in Montclair. You can see the kind of uniforms they were wearing even in 1911. So it was a high-risk sport. St. Michael's had a sports team, and you can see there are people of varying ages in this team. This fellow looks a little on the older side. This is their 1922 team, and we have pictures from some of the church teams. Here's a team that was called the Elite Football Club, only lasted about 2 years or so. And you can find a lot of these. One of the teams was called the White Star Football Team, or the White Star All-Stars. This is one of my favorite old Phoenixville football pictures, because I love the goalpost.
Yeah.
I don't know if you could put a a measuring tape on the goalpost from the ground up. But I would say this is the place to kick the field goal or the extra point, because you got about a 1 foot advantage. And obviously somebody jumped up and split the crossbar, a little bit different than the metal ones that have a single upright now. But these are the kind of teams you saw. Heine Boiler Company had a team, would play other local teams, factory teams, et cetera.
Where was that located, Mr. Ertell?
A lot of the teams used the same fields. And initially, when Phoenixville first teams started forming in town, there was no football field anywhere in the area. And over near Manawatt Street, there were some empty farm field areas. An area was called Buck's Woods. And people laid out a football field there for a while. And then up where Griffin Street is in Virginia, in that area, just past the hospital parking lot where the ground is very flat, there was somebody had laid out a field there and was used for a couple of years. But the big thing is that in the early part of the 1900s, this union club gets formed, and they raise the money and they erect Phoenixville's first genuine football field. And that's called Union Field. And we're going to talk about that in a moment. I even have a photograph of it that I think you'll find interesting. Here's St. Michael's team from 1921. Battery C, the National Guard artillery group, they actually had a football team. This is their team up at Toby Hanna in 1922 when they were up there for National Guard duty for a couple weeks. And they had a team for a couple years. Here's St. Michael's team. Again, somebody had replaced the crossbar and then they had to fix this one too, but at least it's straight. So you have a lot of these teams. By 19, there's the church in the background, in fact. And there were teams of younger kids too. There was a group called the Second Avenue Wildcats. They look ferocious, don't they? So you have a lot of these neighborhood kinds of teams. Even up until World War II, this is a team that was called the Triborough team. It was made up of players from Phoenixville, Spring City, and Royersford. And they would play teams in the region. We're lucky this is one of them that has names on it. And if you go through this, there are several Phoenixville names on here. Here's a Gobonic, for example, and a Latshaw, and a Faddis, with the first three names listed there. They played their games up in Royersford for most of their games. The best known club is the one called the Union Club. And it was founded in 1907. And it was originally made up of local athletes. Later on, when they decide to really get going, they start bringing in players from the outside and paying them money. So that by the time you get to the 1920 team, which we're going to talk about quite a bit here, they're basically almost a professional team. And by the late 19-teens, you start to have pro teams founded in the United States. And the predecessor of the National Football League is a league made up initially of teams that are in Indiana and Ohio and Illinois and Western New York, so that one of the first professional football teams in that league was a team called the Buffalo Bills, for example. And when the American Football League was founded in the late 50s, early 60s, and Buffalo was given a franchise, they took the name from this team that had existed 60 years or 50 years prior to that. But the Union Club was initially made up of local players. They were made up of people that had just graduated from high school, worked in local factories. This is their first team. And if this background looks a little fuzzy, this is a newspaper picture from the time. And they are on the steps, what had one been the steps of the Episcopal Church in town, St. Peter's. And in fact, this is their 1908 picture. It's a little clearer. You can see UC Union Club. And then this is another picture. And this is a picture from the teams, and I want to point out a person to you for a minute. And it's this fellow right here. And I'm going to be talking about him a little bit as we go along. It's a man by the name of Walter Irick. Okay, there was an Irick butcher, family of butchers, ran a meat market in Phoenixville for a long time. He was one of the stars of the Union Club, but before that he was one of the high school's first football stars. And we're going to talk about him a little bit. This is the Union Athletic Club field. And it was located, let me show you where it was located, okay? If I hold this picture up to everyone, anybody can figure out what you are looking at here, okay? Figure out where you're looking? No? How about if I do it this way? Start with this one. Everybody see the Schuylkill River here?
Yeah.
Okay. And here's the bridge over the Schuylkill River. And here is Star Street. And this is where the Union Field was located. It's just beyond where the old Borough Hall had been located, across the street from St. Peter's Place. And if I switch to this picture, here is St. Peter's Place, and here is Star Street. If I turn it this way, here's Star Street. Okay, everybody with me now?
Yes.
Okay, and this is where their field was located, right in here. And it was an active sports field into the 1920s. Of course, there are no remnants of it left today. But this is where they were located. The Union Club was founded not just as a football team, but as an athletic club. And over the years, they had baseball teams, they had basketball teams, and they actually ran track meets from time to time on this piece of land. And in fact, in the 1910 Phoenixville Homecoming book, they actually have this photograph and a photograph of it set up as a baseball field. And you can see track running around it as well. So this is the first real sports field used on a regular basis for sports teams in Phoenixville. The Union Club was made up of basically local players. Once again, here's this fellow right here in the middle in 1912. And we're going to talk about him and another player from the team and how dangerous it was. In 1913, and if I go back, this is the fellow you're going to see in the next picture again, okay? He was the player coach of the Union Club, and he was a graduate of Ursinus College. He was their captain, their coach, player coach. He got injured in a game with Pottstown, broke his neck. Said it was a clean hit and all that, but he broke his neck. He died a week later, this is 1913, died a week later. And because of his death, the team canceled their games for the rest of the season, and Phoenixville High School canceled all of their games for the rest of the season because of this. This is the biggest football tragedy for players in the early years of Phoenixville football. But the Union Club continued. This fellow by the name of Irick, his name was Calvin Irick, excuse me, over here. After he graduated from Phoenixville High School, he played, and then he was eventually the head coach of the Union Club. And when the Union Club almost went out of business as a result of athletes becoming on the short end of it with World War I coming along, he is the key figure that puts the Union Club back together, and they have this great 1920 season. And this is what they looked like in 1915 on the Union Field, Union Club Field. And 1916, they were a championship team. Here's Calvin Irick right here in the picture. But World War I has this devastating effect on local football. Because in World War I, a lot of these teams dry up. Because when the United States enters the war in the spring of 1917, they institute a draft. And so a lot of people get drafted into the military, or they go to work in defense factories, don't have time to play sports. And so a lot of teams that are non-school teams start to fold in the fall of 1917. And in 1918, a lot of them don't exist at all. And then they try to make a comeback after the war is over. And what happens is the war is ending. If you're not aware of it, there was a worldwide flu epidemic hit the world. And in fact, they estimate the number of people died from the flu. This is pre-antibiotic days. That the number of people that died in the worldwide flu epidemic exceeded the number that were actually killed in World War I, according to some records. And you can find pictures if you explore the worldwide influenza epidemic. You can actually find pictures of people in Philadelphia walking around with surgical masks on, just like we used to see these pictures of people in China like that, mm-hmm. being fearful that they'd be contagious to others. So between the war and the flu epidemic, this has a terrific impact on communities having football teams. Excuse me, I'm fighting the cold a bit here. So, 1919 rolls around and the Union Club plays hardly any games and these other teams play hardly any games. And a group of people come together early in 1920, led by a man named Arthur Keenan, who was a local worker, eventually worked at the Phoenix Iron Company and later on had his own business as a carpenter. And Calvin Eyrick, and here's Calvin Eyrick right here. And they decide to organize or reorganize the Union Club. And they have a meeting in town, and they ask businessmen to come to a meeting and want a group of businessmen to each put up $50 to buy a share in a football team. This is where the professionalism comes in. And their goal was to raise $5,000 to field a team. That shows how little people would be paid. They were successful in raising $7,000 and started approaching people who were college football players or recent college football graduates to sign up and be members of this new Union Club team. And there's some very famous early football players in this photo that none of you would recognize by the picture. But fellow right here next to Pops Keenan is Lou Little. And I don't know if anybody recognizes that name, but he was an All-American football player at Columbia University. This is when the Ivy League had big-time football. Later was the head football coach at Columbia University. And in fact, the major sports award given at that university is in his name. And he's in the Football Hall of Fame, etc.
He was a Phoenixville boy?
Pardon?
He was a Phoenixville boy?
No. He was one of these ringers.
Oh, okay.
Recruited. And in fact, the 1920 team you are looking at, we've only been able to identify a handful of their players. But I have a list of the 26 people on their team. 13 of them were All-American college players. Mm-hmm. 13 out of the 26 were All-American college players from schools like Dartmouth, Penn, Brown, Colgate, Eastern teams, Lehigh, one of the running backs was from Notre Dame, Princeton, University of Pennsylvania, South Carolina, Marshall University, etc. And a lot of them actually played on other pro teams. And I think it's kind of interesting because some of you may remember Pennsylvania used to have these laws that were very restrictive on what could and couldn't be done on a Sunday, called blue laws.
Yeah.
And in the 19-teens and 20s, professional sports activities were prohibited on Sundays in Pennsylvania. And so the Union Club, what they would do is they would play games on Saturdays. And they would recruit guys from other pro teams to come to Phoenixville and play on Saturday, get a train that night, and go to wherever their team was to play the next day. And you imagine playing 2 days in a row. But players would come here, and then they'd hop a train to go to Buffalo, or they'd go to New York City, or they'd go out to Columbus, Ohio, or Canton, Ohio, or Cleveland, to play a game the next day, believe it or not. And so several of these fellas all played on other teams, for Buffalo, for teams up in New York State, out in the Midwest, etc. The player coach was this man named Calvin Irick. His nickname was Fat Irick, not because he was a fat guy. He was actually short and stocky. He was the fullback. He was called the human plow because of the way he plowed into the line carrying the ball, but because his father owned a meat market, and that's why the name stuck. Later in life, when he had retired from sports, he was actually a butcher at the Valley Forge General Hospital during World War II. Interesting enough. Now, he's born in 1890. Okay, so by the time he hit World War II, in 1941, he's into his 50s. But graduated from Phoenixville High School in the class, I believe, of 1909. Played with the Union Club after that, coached with the Union Club. He coached Phoenixville High School for a number of years, coached some of these local sports association teams all the way into the 1930s. Actually, when he died in 1980, the obituary that was in the Daily Local referred to him as Mr. Football of the early years of Phoenixville's sports, interestingly enough. The team captain was actually a man named Heine Miller, who was an end from the University of Pennsylvania. And he is the one that had the connection to all these pro players to pull them in to join. And they brought people in for three of the games during the season. They brought in Fritz Pollard, who was in the Collegiate and the Professional Football Hall of Fame. He's one of the earliest African-American football stars. He played at Brown University up in Rhode Island. This is Lud Ray from the University. He was the center at the University of Pennsylvania. Lud Ray and another gentleman in the 1920s purchased a team called the Frankfurt Yellow Jackets, reorganized them, and they became the Philadelphia Eagles. So actually the Union Club's team actually has a connection to the establishment of the Philadelphia Eagles, if you think about it. It's kind of indirect. Yeah. But one of the people that was involved with this as an official was Burt Bell, who was later the first commissioner of the National Football League. So there's a Philadelphia connection here. And in 1920, they beat the team from Conshohocken. Can you imagine the newspaper calling a team today the Conshohockenites? Oh my goodness. And that was their big rivals and made them the champions of Eastern Pennsylvania. Now, in case you wonder who these teams played, here are the opponents of the 1920 Union Club. The East Falls Athletic Club, the Ewing Athletic Association of Philadelphia, the Blue Stars of Bethlehem, the All Collegians of Lancaster, the Mount Carmel team, the New York Ship Company team, Shenandoah team, the Lithuanian Club of Edwardsville team, Holmesburg's football team, Conshohocken's football team, and then they beat the Frankfurt Yellow Jackets and were proclaimed the champions of Eastern Pennsylvania. And they were so excited about all of this that they challenged the Canton Bulldogs to a game. Now, in 1919, the Canton Bulldogs were the world champions, or at least they called themselves that, of the pro team, that pro leagues that operated in Illinois, Indiana, Ohio, and New York. Okay, they were famous because their three primary running backs across the top were all Native Americans, and it all come from the Carlisle Indian School, interestingly enough. And here's a shot of the three of them from the Philadelphia Bulletin. It's not a very good likeness, but their star was Jim Thorpe, the Olympic athlete and premier athlete, and actually had been voted on the greatest athlete, American athlete in the 20th century, of the Canton Bulldogs. So they scheduled this game, and they played at what was called Phillies Park. Those of us that are baseball fans may remember that back in the early years, the Phillies played at a place called Baker Bowl. And that's where they played this game. And the most expensive ticket was $2.50. Of course, players were getting paid, these guys coming in to work, play a game, and then go someplace else. They're getting paid $50 or $100 to play a game. So obviously, money went a little further in those days. So this was the cartoon that was in the Philadelphia Inquirer about the Union Club playing the Canton Bulldogs in 1920. And this is from the Roto-Reviewer section of the Inquirer. After the game, shows Heinie Miller and Jim Thorpe as the captains shaking hands. And this picture is supposed to show, and this is, cannot get a good quality image of this, of Jim Thorpe being tackled. But the bulletin has a better picture of Jim Thorpe being tackled. And that's a typing error of this. The team was called Big Red, R-E-D, not R-E-A-D, okay? They're called Big Red because the uniforms they bought, the jerseys they bought were red color. And that's the reason. But they won the game 13-7. If you read the details of the game, basically, the Canton Bulldogs went up and down the field the whole game, but the game was played basically between the 20s. And then there was a turnover, and the Phoenixville team won the game 13-7. So if you actually looked at yardage in the game, the Canton Bulldogs did everything but win the game. However, the end result of this is that the local media proclaimed this as that the Union Club were the world champions. Now, you'll still hear this from people today. I hear it all the time. If you go back into the record books, nobody recognizes them as a world champion because they didn't have world champions back then. And in fact, in 1920, the Canton Bulldogs were the second place team in their league. But they had this national reputation, and so it gets publicized. So the Union Club tries to make a go of it for one more year. And in the early 20s is when the National Football League gets founded. And it becomes a merger from this other league and some other teams. And so 1921 was the last year of the Union Club. The Union Club has this incredible record. And if you take a look all the way down the bottom there, points for and points against in their career. They scored 2,307 points and gave up 275. That's in their entire career. And they were 95, 8, and 10. Ties were much more common back in those days. So the Union Cup is this legendary Phoenixville team. Let's talk about high school teams for a minute here. High school teams started in the 1890s, but they didn't officially start until after 1900. And when you start digging into it, they would have teams called the high school team, but if they didn't have enough players to get people that already graduated and put them on the team. So you didn't have the eligibility rules we think of today that you have to be a registered student and you have to attend school every day and you have to be of a certain age. And so you had a couple different groups that called themselves high school teams. Here's a group that called themselves the Church Street Athletes in 1896. And here's the 1904 high school team. And obviously you had fewer players in those days because people played both ways. And basically all you're doing is running the ball. And it's interesting, there was a big issue about the gouging and biting ears and all of this stuff. So they actually published in the newspaper back then a sportsman's 10 commandments. And that a sportsman doesn't boast, they don't quit, they don't make excuses when they fail, play fair, are a quiet winner and a cheerful loser. I like that, okay? That's one of the things I tried to emphasize when I was an athletic director, to be gracious in victory and defeat a little bit. Some people have trouble handling that. But so you didn't have players, they didn't want players gloating over somebody. Talk about the taunting rules and stuff today. And where this comes to play is you have this great incident happen in the history of Phoenixville High School football. In during the school year, the superintendent suspended a student for not showing up at school. When he was on the football team and he kept showing up at practice. And the superintendent told the coaches, none of whom were teachers, that you cannot play him in any games. He's not coming to school, he can't be on the team. Well, they had a game and they played him anyway, and the superintendent went through the roof, and the end result is the superintendent decreed that the team is shut down for the rest of the season. Now, even in this early era, you can imagine how well that would go over in Phoenixville here to announce the entire season's canceled. So they have a big meeting and get together, and they agree that one, this kid whose name we will not mention, goes off the team, but that the team can resume with one difference. And that is, in 1907, the superintendent of the school district becomes the head coach of the football team for the rest of the season, and in fact, for the ninth, he and the principal of the high school are the coaches of the team in name only, because apparently they knew nothing about football. But they were going to make sure that only the right people played. And so the coaches had to become the assistant coaches, and they really did the X's and O's and stuff. And the team got billed as Laramie's Bad Boys. And so in 1907, the nickname of the football team was Laramie's Bad Boys. And the balance of the season through 1908, superintendent and the principal's name was Isaac Doughton, were listed as the head coaches of the team. And it's only when you get to 1909, apparently this kid's long gone by then, and we can go back to normal. So here's the 1908 team, and here's Calvin Irick right in the middle of it. Someone that I mentioned earlier. Calvin Irick, right dead center. Once again, you got a team mascot down there. And this is the 1910 team. And they are on the steps of the new high school. And here's the 1914 team. And it's interesting. They played on the Union Field, by the way, down on Star Street. But this is the old hospital building in the background. Some of you may remember that. Mm-hmm. But once again, look at the shape of the football. Much more like a rugby ball. Here's the 1916 team. Well, here's our little mascot. Another shot of the 1916 team. 1920. And this is when things start to change. By this time, Calvin Irick, and am I driving you all crazy hopping around? Here's Calvin Irick. He's now the head coach of the high school team. Okay. And here he is up here in the suit. And by 1924, the gentleman who ultimately becomes the principal of the high school, Wilbur Jim Robinson, is up top here as well. And the world changes in 1926. The school district buys Washington Field, which was a horse racing track, from its owner for several thousand dollars. In fact, it cost more money to buy the field than it did to build the high school on that road. And this becomes the site of Phoenixville football from that point on. And for many years, it had the original grandstand for the horse racing track, and it had the horse trotters railing around it as well. And of course, this is South Main Street over here. And this is what eventually becomes Gay Street, the end of Gay Street. What you'll notice in 1926, there's no field house here. Field house was built after World War II. They actually had a fundraiser to build that. And 1927, Phoenixville starts fielding teams. Late 1920s, they build Memorial Junior High School, and they launch a sports program, and they have football teams starting in the 30s, a couple of their early teams. Now, where the legend of the Phantom comes from is in 1932, Phoenixville hires this man, Kurt Winicky, as their head coach. He comes from outside of the area, and within 3 years, he has an undefeated team, and this is where the nickname the Phantoms comes from. Philadelphia sports writer from the Philadelphia Inquirer, Herb Good. And I might mention that the Philadelphia Sports Writers Association annually gives an award to the, like, their sports writer of the year. That's called the Herb Good Award. So he was this long-term legendary sports writer in Philadelphia and kept writing about this team in Phoenixville that keeps winning games and nobody knows much about them, this mystery Phantoms. And the name Phantom stuck. And that's from that point on, from 1934 on. Before that, they were just the Phoenixville football team or baseball team, or they were the purple and whites or whatever. But the Phantom sticks in 1934. And so here's some teams from the 30s. And by the 30s, what we usually think of with football starts to happen. You have marching band. Love that marching band costumes there in front of the old grandstand. And you start to have cheerleaders. And you start to have bonfires and so on. And you start to have performances on Washington Field with big crowds. And by the late 1930s, the trophy case starts filling up as Phoenixville becomes, they have formed leagues by this point in Chester County and suburban leagues. And you can see some of these trophies are still up at the high school, by
the
way. And
then the balls, they look a little smaller
yeah.
now, more?
Well, a lot of them, they will not hold air.
Okay.
And in fact, I had one from, Phoenixville used to play Coatesville at Thanksgiving. And we found a Thanksgiving game football with the score on it from, I think it was 1943. We're not whole there. So we had to stuff it with rags to put it in the showcase. So I would not be surprised that that's what happened here. Anyway, Coach Wynicke coaches the Phantoms for 11 years. And then in 1942, he is too old to serve in the military, but he wants to serve his country. And so he becomes a field service officer for the American Red Cross, and he goes overseas setting up field hospitals for the Red Cross and takes a leave of absence. And so he leaves Phoenix at the end of the war, he comes back to Pennsylvania and officially resigns. So he had coached Phoenixville from this period from 1932 into the 40s and won all these championships, etc. And he becomes this legendary coach. Probably the most famous athlete from Phoenixville is in the 30s, Nick Baska. Nick Baska was graduated in the 1930s, plays football at Villanova University, and signs with the Philadelphia Eagles. And I wanted to use World War II as our stopping point because a lot of things start to change then. And Nick Baska is a good example of that. He plays one season with the Philadelphia Eagles, and in fact, they play on Sunday, December 7th, 1941, the Pearl Harbor Day. It's announced during the game because of the time difference between East Coast and Hawaii. And 3 days later, he resigns from the Eagles and enlists in the Army. And he serves in the Army until he is killed in Europe in December of 1944. And after World War II, there was a local community football league that was formed. It was called the Nick Baska League. Lasted a few years. He was probably Phoenixville's greatest football player of the pre-war years. And I just went one step too far. So there you go. Anybody have any questions? I kind of went through a lot of things here fast. Just in case you're curious, in the early years, the rules of who you could play and who you didn't play were really kind of strange. And high school would play teams that today we would never allow them to play. For example, they would play students from Ursinus College. They could never have a high school team play even college freshmen today, because of the age differential and supposedly maturity levels. But they would play clubs, they would play, I made a list of the typical opponents that Phoenixville High School played. Conshohocken High School, Spring City High School, Royersford High School, the Ursinus College Reserves, the Ardmore Athletic Association, Williamson Trade School, Paoli High School, that's the ancestor of Conestoga High School, Pottstown, Cheltenham Military Academy, Perky Elman Seminary, the Pierce Business School, kind of Norristown, the Union Club, the kind of teams they played. They actually would play teams in the military at one point. They played the football team from the USS Battleship Idaho, the Battleship Montgomery, which I had never heard of, the Battleship Massachusetts, and the USS Pueblo, which was a cruiser. And they were the kind of teams that schools played. Now what happens is over the years, things get regulated. In the 1920s and 30s, you start to have the regulation of rules and eligibility, et cetera. The group that governs high school sports in Pennsylvania is the Pennsylvania Interscholastic Athletic Association, and they're formed in the 1920s. The NCAA develops a rules committee, and one of the earliest coaches of the Union Club is a man named Walter O'Kesson, O-K-E-S-O-N. He had been a graduate of Lehigh University, an All-American football player at Lehigh, and came to Phoenix. We had a degree in civil engineering, came to work at Phoenix Iron Company, and actually was, among other things, one of the earliest coaches of the Union Club. And he coached the Union Club for 5 or 6 years, and then he left to go take a job with Lehigh University. And he ultimately became the vice president of the university. But in the 20s, he was appointed to the NCAA Rules Committee. And in the 20s and 30s, he became kind of the guru of college rules and had a lot to do with determining the qualifications of people to be officials in a football game, et cetera. He died during World War II, about 1943. But he was actually a vice president and treasurer of Lehigh University by the time of his death. But hardly anybody's ever heard of him, except people like me. Any questions? Yeah.
The guy, his nickname was Fats?
Fat Eirich.
Fat Eirich. You said he passed away in 1980?
About 1980, yes.
You had been in Phoenixville for a while. Had you ever met the guy?
No, he did not live in Phoenixville at the time of that. He was living, I believe, in Pottstown. He actually coached teams. At one time, he actually coached Royers Ford High School's team for a year or two. But I never did meet him, no. Any other questions anybody has? But if anybody's really interested in some details, there's a lot more about Big Red, the Union Club, than I presented here. And if you are interested, the article that I wrote in March of 2011, I reprinted some copies, and you're welcome to have one of these. Read it. There's a gentleman, if you read my introduction here.
Oh, thank you. Thanks.
There you go. If you read my introduction, there's a gentleman for years has had this magnificent website called Ghosts of the Gridiron, in which he has researched all these early football teams around, particularly the East Coast, but early football teams in general. And he has wrote a terrific article about the Union Club that is much longer than the article you see there. It has a lot more pictures on it. And he and I got chatting one day because he'd come in to look at some of our pictures at the Historical Society. And I said, your article's great, but it's too long to be in one of our newsletters. Do you have any objection if I would edit it down to be a more manageable size? And he allowed me to edit as long as I gave him credit for it. So his name was John Fenton. I don't know if he's still doing it. He was an older gentleman, but he had some really great old football stories. And if you're really into early sports, it's really quite remarkable. So it's a select group here tonight. Thank you all for coming.
Jack,
I appreciate
the presentation.
Okay. Jack, one plug for the Historical Society. This Saturday, we have a fundraiser going on beginning at 8 in the morning. We have our big winter flea market. And having been down there today to pick up something in the office, there is more stuff than you can imagine.
You saw on
Facebook.
There are photographs posted on Facebook. It is wall to wall and even up the walls.
Some on Friday night or not?
There's a members-only thing Friday night at 7:00 that you can come in and get an early preview sale, as long as you can, they will have a membership list and check you out. Anyway, thank you for coming.
Thanks.